So this is level compaction, the missing manual. This covers a lot of the common use cases that we've run into, a lot of problems that are counterintuitive performance profile or use cases that 90% of the things fit, but 10% don't. We're going to cover the why. Why are we covering a five-year-old tech? The background of LCS, what led to it even being a thing inside of Cassandra, how it affects you, the common myths that we find out in the field, a lot of the misconceptions that we see over and over and over again, and then we'll talk a little bit about what new stuff is coming. Wei and I have been working together at DataStax for about 3 years now. We work on a lot of the same cases, and several of those have been LCS, and they've been LCS where they're completely blown out. And things are way behind in a really bad state. So that gives us a lot of experience with this in the field in real life. And Wei is actually continuing to do a lot of JIRAs related to improving LCS in the future. He'll talk about some of those. So the why we're talking about a five-year-old piece of technology. There's not actually a ton of documentation out there for all the corners, all the gotchas with LCS. This is sometimes stuff that's just tribal knowledge, and this is an attempt to make this more canonized and something that's more widely available and more widely known. Some of this is just use case selection, dealing with sharp edges. And then the intended audience is really people that have been running LCS for a while, haven't hit the sharp edges yet, and we're trying to save you from hitting those sharp edges, or people that are trying to evaluate compaction strategies in the first place when you're new to Cassandra. And maybe you can pick LCS when you wouldn't have, or maybe not pick LCS when you shouldn't. But yeah, that's sort of the goal of what we can expect to give you out of this talk, is give you a better understanding of the internals of LCS and helping pick it and choose it for the right use cases. Here's a brief history of LCS. It's one of the core compaction strategies that's been around since 1.0, I believe. So it's almost 5 years now. There's also tiered compaction strategy, of course, the tiered compaction strategies, which sort of, you know, since TWCS is replacing DTCS. It was heavily adopted, and it's heavily adopted a lot of times by advanced users, or also sometimes newer users that are maybe misunderstanding the goals of it, which we'll cover those later in the talk. And I'm going to talk a little bit here about the history of LevelDB, which is what informed leveled compaction strategy. LevelDB originally was part of the Chromium project, actually part of an embedded browser database. So it has that lineage, and if you look at the spec and the design, it wasn't designed for highly concurrent databases. So that means that everybody that's implemented a LevelDB type implementation inside of their database, whether it was React or us, they've had to do a lot of surgery that was sort of not part of the core spec. And there's actually a good talk by a Basho engineer on this on YouTube. You should actually watch. It actually gets into a lot of the trade-offs that they had to encounter themselves. But that's just the basic background of LevelDB and why we've encountered some of these problems ourselves when we try to implement it in Cassandra. With that, I'm going to hand it off to Wei.
Thank you, Ryan. So I'm going to start talking about some of the design principles of level compaction strategy. And before we go into that, we want to look at one of the key concepts, which is called overlap. Overlap is not an LCS-only concept, but it's quite important if you really try and understand some of the source code of implementation and also some of the JIRA discussions. So here's a small code piece that I got from the implementation. So what you see here is that we have two SS tables that we're trying to compare whether they're overlapping, and we call them current and previous. And the code piece is really just really simple. Current.first less or equal to previous.last, and we'll use an example to go through that. So assuming now we're actually doing two flushes with insertion. So we insert first P1, P2, P3, P4, four partitions, and then we do a flush. And the flush will be showing up as a new SS table, as a blue colored SS table. We call that previous. Next flush, P5, P6, P7, P8, and flush and the black color SS table. So now we have two SS tables. Do they overlap? We use this equation. So current.first would be that the first line on that current SS table block, and the previous.last is the last line in the previous SS table. So what you can see here is that indeed they're overlapping because the, if you compare the token values, that's to the first column in that SS table block, you can see that the token value is actually indeed the current of first is less than the previous of last. And if you want to have a more visual way to see this, because those two colors, they indeed mix together. So I'm just using a select statement from all the values in those two SS tables. You can see that those two colors mix together. So they're indeed overlapping. OK, now that we've gone through the overlap concept, I want to bring you to the design principles. That's too much. I don't recommend you to read all of them. You know, it's just too much. Hurt your eyes and hurt your brains. But I consider that important because I put all this information, not all of them are coming from the documentation. They're actually directly coming from the code comments, from source code. So what I'm going to do instead is that I'm going to walk you through a few highlights so that it's much easier to follow. First principle is that LCS always arrange SS table on multiple levels. And then any new SS table almost always show up in level 0. And only level 0 SS table can be of any size. And if you have any higher level, L1, L2, L3, those levels, they can only have 160 megabyte SS tables. And that number is actually determined by a parameter. But right now, let's assume we are using the default, which is 160. There's some minor exceptions, so I'm not going to talk more detail in that, but right now, just keep that in mind. And then L0 can also, only L0 can have overlap. Nothing, any of the higher level, L1, L2, you cannot have overlap, otherwise you're in trouble, your read will have problem. And then for each level, like LN, they're supposed to be accommodated up to 10 to the N SS tables. Okay, so the next design principle I'm also going to highlight only the most important piece. So the most important part is that on this one is the compaction score. You need to understand the concept of compaction score and how that's calculated. That's based on the total size of a non-overlapping, non-compacting SS tables in each level. And then you divide that by the level's capacity. So in that case, you get a compaction score, and you will always compare that to a number that's called 1.001. And if you're greater than 1.001, then this level will receive attention from level compaction. So then you'll start doing some compaction with that level. Another rule is that if the L0 is too far behind, anytime any higher level before it even starts the compaction, it will check if L0 is too far behind, which means if L0 ever have any more than 32 SS tables, it will always try to do size-till compaction in level 0 first. Then another rule is that after you have to go through, from the highest level to the lowest level, you have to go through all the levels, then it's a chance for you to do a level 0 regular compaction so that you can do L0 to L1 up level. Hopefully, at this time, you understand what up level, what I mean by up level. Basically, you got this, anytime you have a piece of data that's going from a lower level to a higher level, that's up level. So that's what I mean here. I'm going to use a really quick demo to show that, a kind of animation to show that. By this, I'm going to create a small table that is we call it KV store. And the key is actually just an integer. That's my primary key. And my value is a 40 megabyte blob. In production, I would not recommend you to use a 40 megabyte blob. This is really just for demonstration purpose, right? So it's much easier because you can now have every full partition to fit into a single SS table. So that's much easier for me to draw some diagram here. Then I'm also going to just follow the sequence. I'm going to insert partitions with key 1 to 8 and trigger flush, and insert another 9 to 16, another flush. So I'll do a total of 4 flushes, and let's see how the data bubble up into different levels. As a precaution, you may be wondering why I'm only showing like 4 SS table on level 1 and 16 SS table on level 2. The reason for that is because I just don't have enough pixels on this screen to show you like 100 SS table in level 2. That's just too much, right? So I just simplified the illustration. So okay, now let's move on. To the left is basically all the data I'm currently inserting. And if you look at the color here, the blue color is my first batch of data I'm inserting. That's from 1 to 8, partitions. So I'm doing do a flush. That flush generates the SS table. That's a blue colored SS table that show up on L0. Another flush, 9 to 16. I have another SS table that all show up on level 0. And if you notice here, they are all sorted by the token value, right? So with this two SS tables, you can also see that just in the intuitively, you can see that they are both colors intermixed together. So they are overlapping. So those two SS tables on the L0 level is overlapping, right? So next, I don't have anything on any other level, only level 0. But as long as level 0 has anything that's, as long as level 0 is not empty, it will trigger compaction. So in this case, it will say, oh, I find two SS tables. They're both overlapping. I'm going to add them both into my compaction candidate. So as a result, I basically take all this information from the two L0 SS table. I'm sorting, I get all the information, and then I'm sorting them based on their token value, and I'm lining them out as four additional SS tables on level one. So this level one, basically, you can see that they're all sorted based on the token values, but they are all those four SS tables on level one, they're not overlapping because they're on separate ranges on token values. So at this point, level zero can be gone because all the data has now migrated over to level one. So at this point, because level one is supposed to, accommodate up to four SS tables, so we're basically in a steady state. Nobody else is going to, if I don't have any more flushes, don't have any new data coming in, I will be just staying like this forever. Okay, so now we do another flush. So this time, it will be represented by the purple color. So the purple color will show up as a new SS table. If I flush, it's another SS table on level zero, and then at this time, I have to change the drawing a little bit because it's just going to be too much. I don't have enough pixels to show that much information. So what I'm going to do is simplify by turning 90 degrees and remove all the token values. And the only meaning of the token values is really just to help you to show the order within the partition from all these partitions, within the SS table from all these partitions orders, right? So in that case, I'm just removing a lot of information and make that simplified like this. You're still having that fresh flush that's going into L0 that is 320 megabyte SS table that has eight partitions. Each partition is 40 megabytes, just remind you. And then L1, you still have that four SS tables. At this point, it's going to start looking at L0 and L1 and trying to find if there's any L1 SS table that's overlapping with this one L0 I just flushed. And turns out, if you look at intuitively, if you look at this color, this purple color is actually wrapping around all four SS tables. So it's overlapping with all four of them. So in that case, I'm going to generate the result, and the result is actually going into L1 again. So as a result, I'm actually getting six SS tables showing up in L1. At this point, because we are, if you are calculating that compaction score, we are more than 1.001, so that means we're not done yet. We have to do more up level to be able to allow this compaction score go lower than 1.001. So at this point, I'm going to just basically pick the first two SS tables. I'm actually telling this two SS table to be a compaction candidate, and then they're available for the compaction executors to pick them up, and then because I may have more threads, you know, have more concurrent compactors, so each one of them can pick a SS table, and then just in parallel, they'll try to up-level those two SS tables. Now, at this point, we got two L2 SS tables and four L1 SS table, and if you calculate that compaction score again, they're in a steady state, they're in a happy state, unless you have more flush happening, which is the next one, the final flush I'm going to show. So the final flush is represented by the red color, and they show up as a new SS table, another 320 megabyte SS table, and at this time, it's going to check from this L0, I'm going to check with L1 whether I'm overlapping. However, one thing I want to make a note here is that whenever you do up level here, you never go beyond your next level up. You never look at L2, L3, L4 if you're just trying to do an L0 up level. So in that case, I'm only checking the overlapping from L0 to the four L1 SS table. In this case, it's indeed still overlapping. So as a result, similarly, we'll get the six additional SS tables. So now we're judging on that compaction score again. And In this case, yes, we have to up-level two more SS table from L1 so that we can get back to the steady state. But one trick here is that we actually have another additional thing that's in track by lower compaction. That's called lost compacted keys. So in this case, our lost compacted keys is 19 because that's the lost SS table, the lost key in the lost SS table. I just did the up-level. So based on that, I will do a comparison of 19's token value compared to the first value, first token value in my SS table. And apparently, this 28 does not meet my requirement because the token value is less than that 19. So you have to use number 4, which is the second, the first value of the second SS table. So that token value is greater than 19. So now basically the second SS table, third SS table, they are available as a compaction candidate, and they will be picked up by a compaction executor, and they will up level. So at this time, you got 4 L2 and 4 L1, and there's no more compaction score that's greater than 1.001, so you're ready. Okay, so let's also quickly go through the some of the concepts. One is the fully expired SS tables. So what this one means is that if you ever have any SS table contain only tombstones and it's guaranteed that the SS table is not shadowing any of the data in any other SS table, then compaction can drop that SS table. However, if you ever have any shadowing from this tombstone to shadowing some other data, some piece of older data in some other SS table, then you cannot drop it. So this is basically why this affect LCS, because LCS may have a piece of data, a piece of data of a partition to be showing up on multiple levels. And if you actually have some older data that's on a higher level, then until this tombstone, because the tombstone, whenever it enters the system, it always go from the lowest level, from level zero and bubble up. And if that tombstone hasn't got a chance to bubble up yet, then you cannot drop any of the data there. So that's one of the things that we'll talk about in the miss part, in the miss buster part, that why I do delete the, I don't reclaim space. Okay, so another concept is the write amplification. So what happens here is that all the fresh data enters level zero and we'll have to move up at level one by one, and there's no skipping level possible. So L0, L1, L1, L2, you cannot do L0 to L2. So that's important to understand. And then in this situation, ideally, highest level will have 90% of data. That means the more data, then you have more write amplification, because any data that eventually show up in the highest level N will have to be already being written N plus one times. So this is one of the reasons why LCS is more expensive in terms of CPU and IO capability compared to SDCS, the size-tier compaction strategy. next slide is actually a really nice feature that was recently introduced in this Cassandra 3.2. It's massive, so I don't want to spend a lot of time, but I want to highlight a few points here. Original intention of this Jira was to address a zombie restriction problem. So basically, if you have a partition fragment that you're written into a one JBOD volume, and you have a newer tombstone written into another JBOD volume, and if you happen to have the JBOD volume fail, then that tombstone goes away, then you may have zombie restriction. So what they're trying to address here is that they're trying to make sure that whatever the data that's belonging to the same token range will go into just only a single JBOD volume. And they design, for each JBOD volume, they have one flush writer, dedicated flush writer, and one compaction strategy. But this actually have a very nice side effect for lower compaction, because now you can actually have more parallelism for compaction. Because everybody's just managing its own token range, so that you don't have to worry about on a higher level, you may have some kind of overlapping. And they also make the LCS to be more able to handle more data per node, because each JBOD one is doing compaction on its own. Okay, so now let's talk about some best practice, how it affects you. First, where LCS fits the best. So the first situation is that you have use cases that need a very consistent read performance with much higher read-to-write ratio. And another situation is that you have a wide partition data model, then but the total number of partitions is limited or only slowly growing. However, you do have a lot of updates and deletes, or your data set is fully TTL. It's a perfect kind of situation for lower compaction. I also listed a whole bunch of anti-patterns, but it's too much to go over all of them, so I'm going to highlight a few. So the first thing to keep in mind is that whenever you have any situation in level compaction that you may generate too many L0SS tables, that's really bad for level compaction. And I actually, later in the visualization, I will show you why it's bad. And then if you ever have any like high density node, which means that you have like more than 1 terabyte of data that have been managed by level compaction, or you have a 500 gig of data that's per secure table per node that's using level compaction, you may be going too much. Level compaction just not able to handle that very efficiently. And then if you have a node that just doesn't have enough hardware, doesn't have enough CPU, and or is using spindle, or is using SAM or FS, just because we saw that in the right amplification slides, level compaction does require way more CPU and I/O, so you want to use enough adequate hardware to be able to support that. So that's another independent if you don't have enough resources. From the troubleshooting perspective, you can, if you actually just freshly move from 2.1 to 3.0, you may be surprised that all those compaction activity in the log entries from system log are now gone. The reason for that is that now they actually got migrated to debug log, and they all go, all the compaction activity related entries are now at the debug level. So you will find them on the 3.0 and up, you will find them in this debug log. And if you want to enable more details, like you know, at a trace level, you can always use this node to set logging level. And these are the two important classes that you want to monitor, the level manifest and level compaction strategy. If you set them to the trace level, you get to capture all the details about what's happening under the hood for compaction. And there's also another one that's actually a feature introduced in the Cassandra 3.6 and above. The Jira number is there, and it basically enables you to use GMX to actually enable a more detailed compaction log, which is mostly machine readable, not quite human readable. If you know really trying to do that. So basically, this one basically is an individual compaction log outside of a system log or debug log, but can be very useful for visualization. And we'll see that visualization in just a minute. Okay, now we're doing the visualization demo. Just to set the record straight, this is actually a I didn't do it. It's a developer. It's a Cassandra committer, Carl Yexigen. So he's also author of this Jira. He also worked for DataStax as a developer. So now I'm going to switch the screen to show you the visualization. Okay. So what you see here is that the top part of this diagram is a timeline that you can actually interactively move your mouse across this timeline. And then the bottom part of this is the basically showing you all these levels, all the SS table that's showing up there. Also notice the color that's showing here. Basically, L0 to L1 compaction is represented as a green color. And STCS, the size field compaction in L1, size field compaction in L0 is purple color. And then there's also black color with the up-level compactions with any other like L1, L2, L2, L3, those up-level compactions, they all show as black color. So if I move my mouse here, you can see that initially I have some L0 to L1 compaction happening because that's, what happens is that I actually just dumped the 100 gig of data. So this 100 gig of data will show up as 935 SS tables. This is all generated by compaction stress. So I'm really, I'm purposely just overwhelmed L0. So in this case, compaction stress by default is generating 128 megabyte SS table files. So I got that many SS table files. So first, this L0 to L1 is picking up 32 of them and make them to be available to show up on L1. And now it ended up at L1 as 160 megabyte SS tables. And at that point, L1, because it's triggered that compaction score check, so now it will say, am I going to do L1 compaction at this point? The answer is no, because L0 is too backlogged. So it's going to do that STCS first. So you see the whole screen for this whole duration. This is all size-field compaction L0 happening for a long time. That's almost like 40% of the whole compaction duration. And until this finishes at the end, and you will see about like 10 L0 SS tables. So at this point, you're basically before this SAS-TO completely finishes, because SAS-TO is always destination, is always the L0, none of the data, like most of the data really hasn't escaped the higher level yet. They are still maintain, they're still staying in the L0. So you have to go through this green part, this green phase. This is another, basically another 40% of the total compaction time. Had to bring that whole 100 gig from L0 over to L1. So after that finishes, you can see that you basically have about 620 L1 SS table as a result of that compaction, that massive compaction that's taking 40% of the time. And at that time, it flipped that floodgate open. At this point, you can do a way more concurrent compactions. So whenever you actually have a lot of data that's building up on L1, it actually can do a very efficient way to leverage a lot of the concurrent thread to be able to do up level. So you can see, like at this point, it will just go to L2, L3, and until the end, we'll see that L1 only have 9, L2 100, L3 is not filled up yet. So at this point, we got a steady state. Okay, now let's switch back to our slides. Talking about the miss busters. So I originally prepared 8 of them, but I don't have time to go over all of them. So I only present 4, and the rest of that is in the slides, so you'll be able to see that yourself. First one is that using level compaction, I can. A lot of people hope that it can avoid size-TO compaction's 50% free space requirement and use up as much as 90% of this space. That's wrong. We just saw that. Because you're, you know, if you actually overwhelm your level 0, you're basically going back to the behavior of size-TO compaction at level 0, and you just need that much more free space. And also, when you think about that green, that green phase we just saw, that's 100 gig input and 100 gig output. If you don't have 100 gig free space, then you know you're screwed up. So basically, make that assumption that just because you choose LCS, you can have a lot more free space. Another myth is that why so many small SS tables show up whenever I start the repair service. The answer is because every repair session will force affected nodes to flush the corresponding main table. So that's the only way you can guarantee that when you do that, generate the Merkle tree to do comparison, you will include all the data. So in this case, if you happen to have a session that just run away, a repair session run away, that trying to schedule repair session back to back, you're just triggering too much flushes, and then you may generate too many SS table, L0 SS tables. And then if you also use vNodes, then because the one range of data tends to spread across many nodes and naturally many SS tables, now when you're trying to streaming that replica difference back, you are more likely to source from many SS tables. So that's another reason why you show up a lot of the L0 SS tables. And myth number 3, why compaction is no longer running? I'm still seeing something like this, right? So why 12 over 10? The reason for that is because it's all based on compaction score we're calculating. So if it happen to be those 12 SS tables, you just add up all their size, they're still less than 1.6 gigabyte, then there's no compaction that's going to be triggered from L1. So myth number 4, why it takes so long to free up this space after delete? Because all the delete, just like any freshly inserted data, they always enter L0 first and then have to wait to bubble up. And if you happen to have some older data that's on higher level and your tombstone just not ready to drop yet, then you cannot free up space until your tombstone actually bubble up to the highest level. Okay, what's coming? What I'm going to see is show you here is that these are all the JIRAs. I've done my research, and I actually put all the versions associated with them. So you want to know more details, they're all here. But I want to emphasize only 2 from here. So basically, the first one is talking about some improvement in the tombstone compaction that it's able now to include the overlapping SS tables so that you can actually drop the tombstone more effectively. If you want to know more detail, this afternoon we actually have a talk about that very feature at 410 in the next room, 210C. And then next one is that I want to point out that from the 2.1 to 3.0, there's also a lot of compaction throughput under stress situation. It improved the throughput by 2x because of all those Cassandra JIRAs. Okay, Upcoming Jira, this is all just some of the Jiras that are all related to level compaction that could be interesting to you. So they haven't happened yet, or they haven't merged to the trunk code yet. But it's ready to you should be able to take a look at that. And then parting sorts. I'd like to encourage you to try out the latest Cassandra trunk code to play with the logging levels, and also test out the larger SS table size in megabytes in your environment. So I actually created Jira to track that because the 160 is really just not necessary. At the time when we decided 160 megabytes, it was based on a very limited hardware platform, 2 gig RAM, and it's a virtualized instance. So it makes sense for you to actually try it on your own if some of the bigger SS table size actually makes sense. And there's also like Compaction Stress is the awesome tool. It just showed up on the trunk code. And that actually allow you to do a simulation of compaction much easier. So I encourage you to check that out. OK, that's it. Questions? As I mentioned earlier, that's a DataStax tool that right now, my guess is that it's very early stage, so it's 0.1 version. So I don't know if they have decided that's going to be part of the Ops Center or not. So you know, that's all I know for now. So otherwise, you know, it's a very early version, so it's not available yet.
Yeah, you said that, my question is regarding myth number one, right? You told that don't assume that you will be having more free disk space when you move to LCS, just because it says that only 10% needs to be kept free, mm-hmm. right? Because at L0 you have STCS only, right? So what is there any thumb rule that this much disk space has to be kept, say 30%, 20%, or it depends really on the use case? And if it depends on the use case, how to check that whether your use case will give you any disk space advantage or not? Because right now we are having disk space crisis. We were using STCS, mm-hmm. and then we fine-tuned STCS recently by making compactions more aggressive by tuning bucket high, bucket low parameters, and then now we have saved more than 25% of disk, right? Mm-hmm. And reads are also faster. Mm-hmm. So we are in dilemma whether to go to LCS. Are we getting any gain there?
To address that question, whether you get any gain from LCS, it's mainly that you need to think about if you do have a very heavy update and delete pattern in your workload, then you might still get gain from level compaction. Because what happens is that level compaction is actually doing way more compaction. So that your data, if it's just update and delete and it's towards the same partition, then they have way more chance to actually touch all these different fragments by just going this bubble up, going this up level. So that if you actually stay with size tier compaction, then some of those old values, they may be just staying in that the big SS table generated. They just don't have a chance. They don't have an equal chance to really get touched. So you will have to spend that extra space to hold those old value. Even though they won't affect your correctness when you're doing the read, they will just taking more space from the size tier compaction.
And if you don't mind to add to that, What you're talking about with LCS is, in effect, preloading and being more aggressive in that compaction up front because it's moving all that stuff up levels. So you're much more likely to piggyback on what Wei's saying. It's like what you're already trying to do with size tiered. The I guess the only thing you really have to worry about is, can you take the increased I/O? But it's a similar concept to what you're already trying to do.
Say calculate that I need to keep this much disk free for LCCS, because 90% is definitely not the case, right?
Right.
You would at least need 70, 80%.
Yeah, so it's more like, you know, you need to look at your ingestion pattern into L0, right? If you're L0, like, you know, I'm doing ingestion of it daily, I'm doing a new set of data that's, you know, maybe updated deletes, that's 50 gig per day, and I'm doing that in one batch, I'm just like overwhelm my L0 with that 50 gig. And that 50 gig is the kind of free space you have to leave, right? You have to prepare for the worst, that L0 to L1 maybe have to spend all that bandwidth to take that 50 gig from L0 to L1. So you have to have that much free space available.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. I was just wondering if you could explain a little more clearly why having dense nodes and LCS was an anti-pattern.
Yeah, that's actually it's mainly based on some of the community experience. So actually, we talked to a lot of committers and MVPs, like, you know, in the community, they're running LCS in production. We actually haven't found anyone that is, you know, using the lower compaction with, like, the highest I have seen is that 1.5 terabyte per node. Higher than that is, we actually see a lot of pain at our customers that when they go even higher than 1 terabyte, they already have a lot of pain with lower compaction to be able to handle that.
And to piggyback on that,
the theory though, like what is the pain? Where is the...
So I believe that the pain is actually the fact that compaction is up front. And so you basically, like with size tiered compaction, you may even compact more over time. That row may be right amplified more over time, but that might be over a year. Where with level, you're automatically promoting all the way up to the top level right up front, right where you go. And so your peak usage pattern is just higher anyway. And density is primarily a function of how long can your compaction keep up? That's true of Cassandra today, regardless of the compaction strategy. And just having those high peaks means it's less likely that you're going to be able to stay caught up. And once you fall behind in LCS, it's inefficient. Like, if you have 10,000 metric tables in level zero, it's not going to catch up quickly. You're paying an algorithmic optimization penalty at that point. Just checking for the overlapping SS tables might take you hours and hours and hours. That's what ends up stopping. It's not so much that you hit a certain level and this stops working. It's just your compaction never catches up. And eventually you go further and further down the path. Is that?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's all the time we have, folks. If you have additional questions, I guess you guys can hang out outside the door for a few minutes. Thanks, everyone.